Set in a Nazi German prisoner of war camp during World War II, how could Hogan's Heroes not be one of the most interesting sitcoms of all time? A takeoff on Billy Wilder's Stalag 17 in 1953, but with more humor and less drama.
Well, Newkirk, well, you look good in basic black.
And with six strong seasons from 1965 to 71, Hogan's Heroes won two Emmy Awards out of an impressive 11 nominations. It was an unlikely comedic triumph, as we watched Hogan and his fellow so-called prisoners do their best war efforts from the inside, always assisted by the incompetence of the German camp leaders. It was full of great gags, countless tunnels dug, and really fine acting from the lot. I'm Nostalgic Nick for Do You Remember, and today we're heading back to Stalag 13 and seeing what the cast of Hogan's Heroes got into after the war ended. If you enjoy this video, please be sure to give it a thumbs up, and don't forget to subscribe and click the bell for notifications. Alright, privates, let's move out. Bob Crane. Colonel Hogan is the senior POW officer at Stalag 13, best known for his quick wit.
Not 1 second later, you said.
Did I say AM or PM?
And being daring, especially during the war. He's the ringleader who easily manipulates the Germans running the camp. Crane was a skilled drummer as a child and eventually got his own morning radio show in LA. He would fill the broadcast with sly wit, drumming, and little guests like Marilyn Monroe and Bob Hope. His show quickly topped the morning ratings, and Crane became king of Los Angeles airwaves. His acting ambitions led to guest hosting for Johnny Carson on the game show Who Do You Trust? But most people remember his Dr. Dave Kelsey on 63 episodes of The Donna Reed Show. This led to him being offered the lead as Hogan, and he helped make it a hit, finishing in the top 10 in its first year. The show gave him two Emmy nominations and a divorce when he separated from his high school sweetheart for Patricia Olson, who played Hilda on the show. They married on the set of Hogan's, with Richard Dawson serving as best man. In 1975, he headlined The Bob Crane Show, but it wasn't well received and only lasted one season. Bob's final acting credit was in 1978 with an episode of The Love Boat. Tragically, that same year, he was found bludgeoned to death in his Arizona home with an electrical cord tied around his neck.
Crane apparently was killed, according to the medical examiners.
Prior to this, Bob had struck up a friendship with a man named John Henry Carpenter, and the two would frequently pick up women and then videotape their sexual encounters. In the weeks before his death, Crane had repeatedly expressed a desire to sever his friendship with Carpenter. Bob's son has stated that his dad called John the night before the murder to end their friendship. Well, the murder weapon has never been found, and the case remains unsolved to this day. Carpenter was acquitted and continued to maintain his innocence until his death in 1998. After the trial, Crane's son again speculated publicly that Olson, his father's widow, might have had a role, saying, quote, "Nobody got a dime out of the murder except for one person." Bob Crane was 49 years old. Werner Klemperer. Colonel Klink was cowardly, conceited, and often subject to playful torment of Hogan and company. Klink's vanity made him an easy target.
You're right. You are an expert.
No, it's genius.
And although he didn't properly fit a menacing Nazi general, for this lighthearted comedy, he was terrific and was the recipient of both Emmy victories for supporting actor. The son of famed orchestra conductor Otto Klemperer, Werner did not follow the same beats as his father and began acting in 1952 after serving in the U.S. Army. He worked on scores of variety TV shows, like four episodes of the Philco television Playhouse. In 1956, he began landing film roles, like his psychiatrist in Alfred Hitchcock's The Wrong Man. But his Klink was certainly his greatest role. And he, along with the other chief German officers, were all Jewish. And he only accepted this pivotal role after the show's creator assured him that Klink would never succeed in his plan. After his father's death in 1973, Klemperer honored him by taking on more musical roles and earned a Tony nomination for his performance in Cabaret in its 1987 Broadway revival. His final role was once again voicing Klink.
I'm not actually Colonel Klink. I'm just assuming his form.
As many icons do for an episode of The Simpsons in 1993. Sadly, Werner died of cancer in 2000 at the age of 80. He was cremated and his ashes scattered at sea. Richard Dawson. Corporal Peter Newkirk was intelligent and loyal, and would speak out if something didn't sit right.
But under no circumstances will we dress as women.
Newkirk was also a clothing and decoy expert. Dawson began his career in England as a stand-up comedian known as Dickie Dawson. Dawson began acting in 1962, one of his first roles being a season 2 guest spot on the Dick Van Dyke Show, playing Racy Tracy. Dawson was considered for the lead Hogan, but didn't have the confidence in his American accent. After Hogan's, he jumped right into another wacky TV role, as a regular on Rowan and Martin's Laugh-In. Due to his popularity on Match Game, Dawson was given his own hosting opportunity for its spin-off Family Feud, where he was well known for smooching the female contestants. The Kissing Bandit smooched so successfully that he had Feud surpassing Match Game in popularity, and regularly took home Best Hosting Awards. The last time we saw him acting was manning the microphone once again in 1987's Arnold action flick, The Running Man, directed by Starsky himself, Paul Michael Glazer. And we have a Starsky and Hutch cast breakdown if you want to learn a little more about his directorial efforts. Richard Dawson used to smoke nearly 4 packs of cigarettes a day, until his daughter convinced him to quit in 1994. Sadly, the damage was done, and Richard passed away in 2012 from complications of cancer. John Banner. Sergeant Schultz is important. He serves Klink as official food taster at parties to ensure that the food has not been poisoned. But he inevitably knows nothing, sees nothing, and hears nothing.
Oh, I see nothing. I was not here. I did not even get up this morning.
He was a true clown and aided this show tremendously. His sense of comedic timing was an inspiration to Bob Crane himself. John Banner began acting in 1940, and his accent led to many typecast roles as a Nazi. His first semi-regular role was in 1954 in the show Rocky Jones Space Ranger. When people criticized Banner Schultz as a cuddly Nazi, he refuted with, quote, "I see Schultz as the representative of some kind of goodness in every generation. Banner lost much of his family to the Nazis' efforts in the 40s, so I'm gonna stand on John's side here." One of his final roles was in 1971, co-starring with Dean Jones in the Chicago Teddy Bears. He then retired and moved to France with his second wife. Sadly, less than 1 year after his European reunion, he died on his 63rd birthday after an abdominal hemorrhage, but the world will forever remember Schultz and his keen observation skills. Larry Hovis. Sergeant Andrew Carter is kind-hearted, enthusiastic, though fairly naive. He received little respect from Corporals LeBeau and Newkirk, who only called him Andrew, not Sergeant. In 1964, Hovis was discovered by Andy Griffith's manager, and was hired to play Private Larry on Gomer Pyle. He was also a regular for 36 episodes of Laugh-In'. But after 2 episodes of Alice in the late 70s, he moved from acting to producing. He began teaching drama at Southwest Texas State, but unfortunately passed away in 2003 of cancer at the age of 67.
It's better than never to have loved at all.
Robert Clary. Corporal Louis LeBeau is very loyal, patriotic, and intelligent, and sometimes gets emotional, especially when he believes that his cooking or his homeland has been insulted. Clary's short-lived acting career began in 1949, and following the success of Hogan, his best-known role, he guest-starred on 164 episodes of the popular soap Days of Our Lives. Then in the 90s, he had a 30-plus episode arc on The Bold and the Beautiful, but this would be his final acting role. Clary also had some real life encounters with the Germans that he had to battle. He was a survivor of the Holocaust, liberated from the Buchenwald concentration camp in 1945. 12 other members of his immediate family were sent to Auschwitz. Clary's tattooed identification number was A5714 on his left forearm. In 2001, he released his memoir detailing both his time in the concentration camps to becoming a Hollywood star, which was aptly named From the Holocaust to Hogan's Heroes. Today, Clary is 95 years old and is also a painter who takes inspiration from the photographs that he has taken on his travels.
It was just a joy, great joy.
Ivan Dixon. Staff Sergeant Kinch is known as the group's unofficial second-in-command, though the communications specialist would depart the show after season 5 due to his actor feeling stifled and overshadowed. Ivan Dixon was an established stage actor, meeting Sidney Poitier on Broadway and becoming lifelong friends with the legend. The two would recreate their stage roles for many films, highlighted by A Raisin in the Sun in 1961. After leaving Hogan's, Dixon concentrated heavier on directing, calling the shots on stellar shows, from 7 episodes of The Waltons in the 70s to 13 episodes of Magnum PI in the 80s. Dixon was an avid civil rights activist and served as a president of Negro Actors for Action. Sadly, Dixon died in 2008 at the age of 76 from complications of kidney failure. What a unique and funny show this really was. So now it's your turn, let's discuss. Who was your favorite character on Hogan's Heroes? Did anyone watch the show for all 6 seasons? Whose career did you follow after the show? Let us know in the comments below, we read them all. And don't forget to give this episode a thumbs up and subscribe for even more nostalgic fun. From all of us here at Do You Remember, thanks very much for watching.